Now, given these, we're going to talk about the properties of what we call indifference curves. This is why I screwed up before. Of course, you can be indifferent between things. That's the whole point of economics. I don't know why I got that wrong. Haven't taught this course in about 6 years, so I lost track of things. OK, properties of indifference curves. So indifference curves are our name for what we also, you could also think of as preference maps. In economics, we like to be able to describe everything, as I said, three ways: intuitively, graphically, and mathematically. Preference maps are the graphical representation of people's preferences, which we do through graphing something called indifference curves. OK, so now let's go to the example I'm going to use, that I'm going to use throughout these next couple lectures, of a decision you have to make. Now, I tried to think of a cool way to make this example cool, and I just couldn't. So it's going to be a boring example. It's going to be, imagine your parents gave you some money, and you had to decide whether to buy pizza or see movies. OK, I tried to make it at least a little bit relevant, even if I couldn't make it cool. OK, you got to decide whether to buy pizza or see movies. That's your decision. That's the trade-off you're making. We're in a world with only two goods, pizza and movies. OK, and you're deciding how to allocate the money your parents gave you over pizza and movies. OK, now let's say that we can, now let's say we're going to consider three choices of pizza and movies. So go to figure 4.1a. OK, we're going to consider you can have two pizzas and one movie. You can have, that's point A. You can have one pizza and two movies, that's point B, or you can have two of both, that's point C. Okay? There's just three choices you're facing. Once again, we're ignoring paying for them. Budget constraints is next time. Now we're just saying I'm giving you these three choices. Well, how do you feel about them? Well, let's assume that you're indifferent, and this is why you can be indifferent. This is what I said before, just strike. Let's say you're indifferent between two pizzas and one movie, and one pizza and two movies. Let's say you're pretty much, roughly, you feel you're, if you had two pizzas in one movie or one pizza in two movies, you pretty much feel the same about them. But clearly, you like two pizzas and two movies better than either of the first two combinations. Okay? Then what we can do is we can draw what we call indifference curves. And that's in figure 4.1b. These are maps of your preferences. An indifference curve is the curve showing all combinations of consumption along which an individual is indifferent. I'll say that again, very important concept. An indifference curve is a curve showing all combinations of consumption along which an individual is indifferent. So you have an indifference curve. I said you were indifferent between A and B. So you have an indifference curve that runs between A and B. That means that all, and I'm assuming, that all combinations along this curve, you're indifferent. So you're equally happy getting two pizzas in one movie or one pizza in two movies. But point C, which is two pizzas on two movies, is on a different indifference curve. You're not indifferent between point C and points A and B. Okay? You're indifferent between A and B. I'm just assuming this. I'm not saying you are, but I'm just assuming. Let's imagine you are. But you clearly like two pizzas and two movies better than one of one and two of the other. So armed with those assumptions, okay, there are four key properties of indifference curves that we have to keep track of. Four key properties of indifference curves. The first is that consumers prefer higher indifference curves. So you prefer higher indifference curves. Prefer higher indifference curves. What I mean by that is the further out is the indifference curve, the more you prefer it. And this comes naturally from the non-satiation assumption. Okay? Given that we've assumed non-satiation, you must always prefer an indifference curve that's further from the origin, because it's more, and more is better. Okay? So given non-satiation, you always prefer indifference curves that are further from the origin. Okay? That follows directly from non-satiation. The second point is that indifference curves are always downward sloping. Indifference curves are always downward sloping. Okay? Indifference curves are always downward sloping. And that, once again, comes from non-satiation. To see this, let's look at the next figure, an upward sloping indifference curve. Why does an upward sloping indifference curve, someone tell me, violate non-satiation? Yeah?
Because you're indifferent to getting more.
Yeah, because this would say you're indifferent between 1-1 and 2-2. It's not quite drawn right. We ought to just have this go through to point 2-2. But basically, this would say you're indifferent between getting one pizza and one movie or two pizzas and two movies. You can't be, because that violates more is better. So indifference curves can't be upward sloping. They've got to be downward sloping by the non-satiation assumption. Okay, that's the second property of indifference curves. Okay, the third property of indifference curves is indifference curves cannot cross. Indifference curves cannot cross. Okay, why can't indifference curves cross? Well, here, I forgot to have Jessica do a pretty diagram, so you have to see why. You have to deal with my ugly handwriting here. So why can't indifference curves cross? Well, imagine a situation where you have your pizza and your movies, okay? And imagine a situation where you have one indifference curve that looks like this and one indifference curve that looks like this. Okay, two indifference curves. And you've got, let's label these points A, B, and C. So transitivity says I must then be indifferent between B and C through the logic you just laid out. But I can't be indifferent between B and C because B dominates C. B has, you know, basically the same number of movies but more pizza, so I must like B better. So by the combination of transitivity and non-satiation, indifference curves can't cross. And finally, completeness, which is the most awkward of these assumptions, it simply means you can't have more than one indifference curve through a point. Okay? So basically, the idea of every possible bundle has one indifference curve. You can't have two indifference curves through it saying, I'm not sure which indifference curve I'm on. I'm not sure how I feel about this. You know how you feel. There's one indifference curve through every bundle. Okay? There's not two indifference curves through a bundle. Okay? So this is the way we think about preference maps, which is the sort of core building block of utility theory.